Hey everyone. So I've gotten a lot of requests over the last little while to talk a little bit more about how I use Notion for organizing my edits. And I've got this really cool template that I've used on my last two shows that I've worked on that I've shared collaboratively with my editorial team. Usually it's myself and like maybe one or two other editors and a couple of assistant editors and a post super. And we've been doing episodic television. So I'm going to take you around this template and show you some of the features. And then if you're interested, you can find out how to access this template by visiting my website, and I'll provide the link down below. So this is a landing page for the show. Obviously, it's a template. You can rename it to whatever you want your show to be called. You can update your cover, Notion cover, to whatever it is that you think you might like for your show, some kind of fun image. I just recently finished working on a show about K-pop, so we were using this like Blackpink random graphic that I found off of the internet, just to give us a vibe, and we had changed the icon to music notes because it's about K-pop and it was fun, but you can customize it to whatever you like. At the very top of the page, I have a little tip in here, new to Notion. See below for some info on how to get started. And this links to a page that I just called Notion Basics. And I just built this with a few videos and some basic information for somebody who's never used Notion before. I've worked with a few editors and assistants. It was their first time using Notion, so I created this. This is part of the template, so you can actually update this as you like if Notion comes out with more videos or you want to explain some more complex things that you have chosen to add to your template. You can update this Notion Basics page for your whole team. The next section here is the Our Team section. So in here, I've got three different databases that kind of help us to organize all of our team members. So we've got our editorial team members. So obviously, for the moment, I've just put myself. We put the role, so editor, assistant editor, post super. I've affiliated with a person, which can come in handy when you're like tagging people in and around the workspace, and then some contact information. I'm also displaying in this particular layout, I'm displaying the operating system that I'm using or that the person is using and the version of the NLE that they're using. If you actually open this up, I've added a few more fields too, like the operating system version, what NLE plugins they might have. For example, if they're using Boris or Isotope, or something else that the assistant editors might need to know about. I've also put the internet type and our average upload and download speed. And this is a lot of information that we often gather at the beginning of a project when we're meeting with our team for the first time to talk about just what our capacities are. So we make sure everyone is on the same page, or maybe everyone needs to be using the same version of the NLE, et cetera. So you can make an entry for each member of your team and have all that information in a handy spot right here. So that's the editorial team member section. Next, we've got a key production crew section, which is just where I think it was important to put some of the key people that we might be getting in touch with from the editorial department. So that could be your executive producers, directors for any of your episodes, the script super, obviously, possibly, the DIT, the line producer, anyone whom the editorial department is going to be interacting with regularly, who are on the production crew. And there's room to put their contact information, phone number, email, name of the production company. And obviously, again, you can add your own custom fields however you like. The next one is the VFX vendors database, which you may not need right away, but you might need eventually. So you will have the name of your VFX vendor, maybe the contact person there, the contact email, the phone number, any notes, and then you can further, again, create more fields to keep track of your VFX vendors. So all of these three databases are actually linked to several other properties in some of the other key databases that I'm using in this workspace. I'm going to come back to this team members landing pages later because once I've explained the trackers, I think it'll make a little bit more sense. So the key part of this template and this landing page is these trackers. So as you can see, I've got a number of different trackers that we can use over the course of the project. And I'm going to start with the episode tracker. So again, we're working on an episodic TV series, so we'll have multiple episodes. If you're just working on a feature film or something that there's only one episode of, you can just leave it with, you can just track it as one episode. But in our case, usually it's like maybe six or eight or 10 or even more episodes that we're dealing with. So in the episode tracker, it's just a standard database. You have a field for the episode. You assign an editor to each episode, which is going to become important later if you want to keep track of who's cutting what episode and also create custom views for each of your editors so they only see their episodes. Under edit status, I have a number of different possibilities. Again, totally customizable to your needs, not started, assembling. It's in director's cut, producer's cut, internal rough cut, network rough cut, internal fine cut, network fine cut, internal proposed picture lock, network proposed picture lock, and locked. You can even add more after that if you want to have like lock cut two, because we all know that happens. There's a space here to put the episode director, which is a drop down from the key production crew. So if you've entered your director into the key production crew database, then you can just select them from this list. And then I also found it really useful for the shows that I've been doing to put the latest cut link in. So if the episode status, for example, is an internal rough cut, there can be a link here to the internal rough cut, as well as the password for the internal rough cut, so that anyone who's looking for it on the editorial team can keep track of where all these cuts live. And then there's also a link for a notes document. So on a lot of my projects, we have a document, usually it's an Excel spreadsheet, or sometimes it's a Word document that has notes, maybe it's producer notes or network notes that we're working on. So the latest notes document can also be linked in this database, and it's really, really easy to find. So you can find the notes and the links for any episode that you or even the other editors are working on. So basically, in order to use the episode tracker, just enter in your episodes, put the episode number, the editor, start with the edit status, the director, and then you can just add information as you go. Next is the scene tracker. And the scene tracker, I think, is like the real bread and butter of what editors really are interested in and care about. So at its essence, the scene tracker is just literally you have an entry for every single scene. There's fields for description of the scene. The process status is for the productions through to the assistant editors. So, you know, if the scene is owing, which means it's in the script, but there hasn't been scheduled or shot yet. Maybe it's been scheduled, it's been shot, we've got the dailies, the bins have been processed, and it's been delivered to the editor. So those tend to be all of the steps that we go through up until the editor receives the scene. I've also created a separate column for script sync status, which is really useful for the assistant editors for when they're tracking the script sync. So there's not started, in progress, done, or maybe not applicable if it's a scene that doesn't need script syncing. And that can be really helpful because sometimes the assistants will deliver a scene to an editor, even though the script sync isn't done yet, because the editor needs to get started or wants to take a look at it. So that's why these are two separate status columns in this database. And then there's the edit status, which is really for the editor to choose. And again, we have omitted, we have pending, which is just like, I haven't gotten it yet. We've got received by editor, work in progress, partial, if maybe it's a partial scene, half of a phone call, something like that. If it's been cut already, and maybe it's been cut and then it's been put into the assembly. So, and again, editors, you can change or add options for this if you want to reword it, or you have different ways of tracking how your scenes are working through their progress. You can just update this as you want. Every scene also has a shoot date, which is also affiliated with the production day. They're always attached to a particular episode. So then by nature of being attached to the episode, you know which editor has been working on it or should be working on it. And then there's other notes. I do have an AE column, assistant editor column, because if the assistants want to assign certain scenes to each other, then they can put their names in. And then I have some other columns too that could be useful, some other fields, music notes, if there's particular music requirements for the scene. There's a frame, which is like an upload of a still frame from the scene. And then I have some various timing stuff, which will come in handy later when we're looking at the continuity and script timing, but I'll just show you here. So there's a script timing estimate, which is obviously the length of the scene as estimated from the script. There's the set timing, so what they think on set, what they timed it as, and then the edit timing, which would be the actual timing that it exists in the edit. And this kind of stuff is really important, as people who work on episodic series know, to constantly keep the timing updated. So here you have all your timing information that's directly connected to every single scene, which will help you later on create an overall timing for an episode. I should note now that Notion doesn't have the capacity, as far as I know, to do math with time. So even though you're going to be adding the time in here, for example, you know, 1 minute and 14 seconds. And then you might add the set timing, which might turn out to be a little bit shorter, 1 minute and 10 seconds. And then the edit timing, actually the editor decided that it needs to be, you know, 1 minute and 30 seconds or whatever it is. So you'll be entering that data in, but if you actually want to be able to do any math with that data, you will have to export this database into like a CSV file and do the calculations in Excel using a plugin that can understand time, because I don't think Notion does that at the moment. But in any case, this is a really good storage spot for storing all of that information, and then you can export it whenever you need it. So going back to the trackers, so we've covered the episode tracker and the scene tracker. So here's the continuity and timing by episode. So this isn't its own database. This is just a view of the scene database. So as you get more scenes here, you can start keep looking at all of the script timing and information here. Once again, you will have to export this stuff in order to actually be able to do the math, but you can always look at it at a glance or do a little bit of manual math if someone asks you for a bit of information. The next thing I have here is an output tracker, which you may or may not decide to use, but for example, you could have 101 rough cut, and then you assign it to whichever episode it is, and then you can provide the link to the rough cut, the password for the rough cut, the date that it was output, and any kind of notes that you think might be important about that. And as I showed in the previous database, in the episode database, there is a separate field here for the latest cut link, but sometimes it's just you really actually want to have every cut available. So you want to be able to go back and see the output that you did of the rough cut, of the fine cut, you know, of the lock, of the pre-lock, or before you watch the lock cut of something. So this is a full database that you can actually just save every single output that you've done, work in progress outputs, whatever, for every episode. Over here on the right, we have two more trackers. We have the VFX tracker and the stock footage tracker. So the VFX tracker is designed to be just what it sounds like, a VFX tracker database. So you can enter all of your information in here. You can view it. You can update it. If you want, of course, you can export it as a CSV or some kind of Excel file so that you can share it with the VFX team. But this way you can keep everything together, and it kind of cross-references with all of the episode and scene information. So you would put in a VFX ID. There's a field for a frame, so you can have actually the actual shot, as we do when we create VFX lists, description of the VFX, the episode that it's affiliated with, which then shows us which editor is affiliated with that episode, and then the status. So, I mean, these are just some really basic statuses, not started, in progress, for review, done, or omitted. You can always add more statuses depending on how your VFX are running through in your project. And then there's a field for the vendor, which basically is a drop down from the VFX vendor list database that I created earlier. So you can actually put the vendor information in. And then obviously you can always add more properties as you need them, depending on what your needs are for VFX for your show. And the last one is a stock footage tracker, which once again, it's just an easy way to keep track of any stock footage that might be in your shows, in your episodes. So there's room for a thumbnail, description, morning, evening, night. I always found very useful when I'm working with stock footage, if I know that I need a shot of a city and I'd like to know what time of day is needed. There's an ID number field, which usually is like whatever the ID code is from the website that you're getting the stock footage from, whether it's like iStock or Pond5 or whatever. So you can put that in, the resolution, the frame rate, the vendor, which is the stock footage vendor. You know, you could even, if you wanted, create a database of stock footage vendors and make this a dropdown, the same way that I did with the VFX vendors. I often don't find that's necessary, but for example, you could just say it's Getty Images or Pond5, the link to the stock footage at the vendor website, obviously which episode it appears in, and it could appear in multiple episodes. For example, if it was an establishing shot of the city, it might be in like almost all of your episodes. And then there's a little bit of licensing information over here, which I find useful. So for now, I've just put it as, you know, three different options: licensing status to be determined, pending means like probably that it's been approved, but you haven't actually received the high-res footage yet, and then maybe that it's been purchased. License issue flag I find really handy, because sometimes we'll be using stock footage and we we won't realize that there's some kind of licensing issue. Maybe that issue is that the footage is too expensive. Maybe it's that it might be actually kind of hard to access, or various other reasons that there might be an issue with licensing the footage. So I just put this little checkbox, which I find handy. And then any licensing information, that's just a text field. You can put in what the cost is or any kind of details that you want to. So that's the stock footage tracker. So you can keep track of all of your stock footage there. And then down in the bottom here, I just created this last little database that I created, which I'm just viewing as a list, is show specific documents and links. So it's just really nice for everyone to have a really obvious place where they can find links to anything that they need. So for example, my Avid bin specs. So anytime I start a new show, I have a little PDF document that I give to my assistants that says like, hey, this is how I like my bins organized. And I like my locators or markers to be this color and, you know, that sort of thing, just like little personal stuff. So I can provide a link to that PDF for them so they can reference it anytime. Often you'll get a dailies workflow chart from your post-production house that will show how everything is going to process through production and backups and the DITs and all of that. So you could link that. And then like all kinds of other stuff. The post-production calendar. So if the post-production calendar, maybe it's on Google calendar and there's a subscription link so that if you click on the link, then you can have access to it in your own Google calendar. So these are just like really handy one-click little entries where you can add a link for any of the items that might be handy. And the last thing I'm going to talk about is this team members landing pages. So obviously we have the landing page here, which is the landing page for the whole show. And inside the episode tracker, you know, we have a couple of different views that I kind of pre-created about, you know, there's a board view and a list view. You know, people really like to see a board, you know, for their scene boards and that kind of stuff. So that's kind of in the main landing page. But sometimes editors and assistants like just want to have their own views and they don't want to mess with how other people are looking at the databases. So what we did on my last show is we created the landing pages for each person. So here's an example of my landing page. So my landing page has some very specific views for me for only the episodes that I am working on. So Jane's Scenes is a page that has a view. This is a view, a linked view of my date of my scene database, and it only shows my scenes. So if you look at the filter, I've filtered it so it's like I'm the only person whose scenes show up here. So the other editors' scenes are not going to show up on this page. Likewise, I did one for my episodes. So there's a filter here that says these are only episodes that I'm editing. I also created a couple of secondary views. So this one is like the VFX tracker view, but it's only my episodes. And this is the stock list view, but it's only my episodes. So you can just customize it however you want, but that's like a really easy way of just creating kind of these separate pages with separate views that aren't going to affect how the other team members see the databases. And then I just threw the documents and links in here because I thought that would be handy for me to have as well. And on previous shows, I've had like more complex landing pages. And I found that like as the show progresses, as we go through different stages of the edit, I want to add or remove different things from my own personal landing page. And it's just really nice to have your own little spot. And the assistant editors had their own landing pages that might have preferenced, for example, the script sync status of their episodes or some other documents or links that they needed. So everyone can just choose their own thing. So this is basically it. This is my workspace. I'm all changing it all the time. And every time I work on a project, I kind of duplicate it and update it and add new things. So I would love for other people to try it out. Let me know what they think. If you like it, if you don't like it, if you find any like weird things about it or cool ideas of how to make it a lot better, I'd love to hear about it. So visit the link down below on my website to find out how to access this template. And thanks for watching.